kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time
I think I'm just
going to
do this,
Bill.
Try to cram in that thing out of there. It's like, okay, so is everybody good to go? Are we all comfortable back in our seats and ready? Okay, awesome, awesome. Well, I do want to take the time to introduce our next guest speaker, Dr. Harry Croft. And Dr. Croft is going to be speaking about Alzheimer's disease and hope for the future. So a very important topic, very interesting information, and I hope you enjoy his presentation. Dr. Croft.
I apologize in advance. I have to leave right at 12 o'clock so for a medical appointment. So, thank you for having me. So, 1906, this doctor, Dr. A, a German psychiatrist named Alois Alzheimer, had a patient, Auguste Dieter, and Miss Dieter was a lady in her 50s, early 50s as I recall, who had memory loss but had delusions and hallucinations. And Dr. Alzheimer had no idea what was wrong with Miss Dieter. She died in 1906. And in order to try to figure out what was wrong with her, at her autopsy, he did slices of her brain, and he used photographic processing fluid to make it come out. And what he saw was what you see there. The glom in the middle is called a plaque, and the black things are called tangles. And he described these for the first time, plaques and tangles in the brain. The disease a few years later was named for him and was called Alzheimer's disease. Now, the sad truth is, if Miss Dieter had been treated by Dr. Alzheimer today, 111 years later, there is very little more that he could have done for her to cure her disease, or actually to keep it from progressing the way it did. She still would have died of her disease. And her disease is, it was kind of interesting. Her disease was thought to be, Alzheimer's disease was thought to be a disease of young people in their 40s and 50s. What happened to old people in their 60s was called senility. And it wasn't until the mid-60s that some pathologists started doing brain stains on people who had died from other things, car wrecks and other things, and found that they too had plaques and tangles in their disease, in their brains. And we then began to think we had an epidemic of Alzheimer's in people's 60s and 70s, because prior to that time, Alzheimer's was limited to somebody younger. We'll talk about that too. So what we're going to talk about in the next 45 minutes or so are these kind of things. The burden of Alzheimer's disease, the difference between the cognitive effects, the thinking effects of normal aging versus dementia. We'll talk about how we make the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease today, which is probably different than the way we're going to make it in the future. We'll talk about the treatments that are available right now for Alzheimer's disease. We'll look at some of the brain changes and what we think causes those brain changes. And then we'll talk about research for the future, hopefully to prevent this disease in the future. And then we're going to end up with what you can do, how you can help in this effort. So Alzheimer's disease is common, and it's increasing. It's very costly, and the cost is increasing. And it's not even today, in 2017, appreciated for the impact that it has on people's lives now, as well as the impact it's going to have in the future. 5 million Americans are suffering from Alzheimer's disease today. A new case presents every 66 seconds. That gives you some idea of how common it is. Of those people 65 years of age and older, maybe 1 out of 10 or so has Alzheimer's disease today. But we're living longer. And if you look at people above the age of 85, that number increases to about 1 out of 3. And here's the scary part. The number of people with this disease will triple in the next 35 years. So it's bad now, but it ain't nothing compared to what it's going to be 35 years from now. Why is that? Because the biggest risk factor for Alzheimer's disease is too many birthdays. And fortunately, we're living longer. And we're experiencing more of those birthdays, which increases the likelihood that more people will develop the disease. It's a costly disease, $236 billion. What does that mean? I don't know. But it's a lot of money, I guess. 1 out of every 5, get this, Medicare dollars is spent dealing with someone with this disease. It's the 6th leading cause of death. It's probably more than that, because we don't record Alzheimer's disease on the death certificate as a cause of death. What we report is the pneumonia that people have, or the infections, or the lung problems that they get from Alzheimer's disease. But it's actually their Alzheimer's disease that causes it. Many of you here know how difficult it is for families and caregivers when someone you love or care about or is in your family has the disease. And if we could just delay the entry into nursing homes by 5 years, we could cut the cost of this disease in half. Cancer and heart disease are bad. They cause 550,000 deaths per year. And Alzheimer causes about that, about 500,000 deaths per year. So the deal is that heart disease and cancer, the numbers of deaths caused by those diseases going down, whereas the number of deaths from Alzheimer's is not only going up, it's expected to triple in the next 35 years. And Alzheimer's disease is the only one of the top 10 causes of death that can't be prevented, cured, or for the most part even slowed down overall. Fortunately, we're doing a good job with cancer, with heart disease, and with AIDS. The government spends about $3 billion per year on cancer, heart disease, and AIDS each. The government spends on Alzheimer's disease up until this year, $0.5 billion, $500 million, and everybody hooked and hollered because this year we increased the spending from $500 million to about $900 million. But that's still less than a third of what we spend on cancer or heart disease or even AIDS. And those conditions we're getting the jump on. And less people are dying from them. And we're doing better in treating them. Whereas with Alzheimer's, we've still got the problem. And remember, the problem will triple in the next 35 years. So let me tell you about Mrs. H. So Mrs. H, I'm Jewish, is a nice Jewish lady who is about 66. She is still doing volunteer work, she's still driving, she's still taking care of the house. And she and her husband are going to a wedding in Dallas. And it's a wedding of their niece. And they can't stop talking about the wedding. She and her husband are talking about the wedding, what they're going to wear, all the people they're going to see there at the wedding, how wonderful it's going to be, and they can't stop talking about it. And her husband looks at her and says, "Honey," he says, "I'm so glad that we're going to get to go to that wedding next weekend." She looks at him and she says, "Wedding? Who's getting married?" Now the question is, what's going on with Mrs. H? Is she just showing signs of normal aging? Or is it something else? Does she have dementia? Does she have something in between normal aging memory problems and dementia? We'll talk about that as we go on. So let's start with normal aging. My wife, who's there, will tell you that my memory ain't what it used to be. She actually bought me this little gadget to help me put the toilet seat down, because I forget. And she'll tell you, I just got hearing aids a month ago, and about half the time I forget to put them in. I forget where my glasses are. I certainly forget where I parked the car sometime in the parking lot. So is that normal aging?
Yes.
And the answer is yes. Our thinking ability tends to peak, as you see there, in our mid-teens to early 30s, and then it kind of goes downhill from there. Especially problematic is information processing and processing speed with which we pick up new learning. But the good news is you see all the things that remain intact as we age: vocabulary, information, comprehension, and the like. And that is normal aging. Forgetting where the keys are, forgetting where you parked your car in the parking lot, may be because you're not paying as much attention, and it's probably just normal aging, as is repeating a few stories that you've repeated your whole life. Benet can tell you some of my stories verbatim. And so this memory loss thing is a spectrum. It's on a spectrum, and it goes from age-related memory loss, which is hopefully what I have, what Benet has, what many of you have as aging. So that's at one end of the spectrum. And then in the middle is something called mild cognitive impairment. I use the term because you'll probably read about that a lot. And so it will help you understand what we mean when we use that term. Mild cognitive impairment is a little more memory difficulty than normal. You can pick it up on some of the tests we use, and other people can pick it up fairly readily. But it doesn't interfere with a person's ability to function independently. They can still drive, they can still volunteer, they can still do the things they did without the need for help. And then dementia is at the other end of the spectrum. Mild cognitive impairment implies a memory problem that's severe enough to be noticed, and you can pick it up on test, the kind of memory testing we do. I'm the principal investigator on several trials for Alzheimer prevention trials at clinical trials in Texas, and Cindy over there is from CTT. And what we do is we do these memory screen tests. I'll show you a little about that. And for mild cognitive impairment, people make some mistakes. That's more than just normal aging, but they're still functioning. Here's what we use to measure memory. What we use as our screening instrument is called the MoCA, the Montreal Cognitive Assessment Tool. I'll show you the MoCA in just a second. The one that's commonly used in doctor's offices is called the MMSE, which stands for the Mini Mental Status Exam. And in the MMSE, they ask you questions and ask you to fold papers and do things with it and remember several objects and so forth. And that's the one that we usually use as the screening test. And the screening test will pick up mild cognitive impairment. And then there's another one that you sometimes read about that they use called the St. Louis mental status. It's called the slums. It's a kind of bad name, I think. And then there's a test called the mini-cog. And that's a very simple test. I don't have pictures of it, but you can Google it. Google the mini-cog. And it's a test that has two parts. And the two parts are you give a person several words to remember, and then you ask them to draw the face of a clock and to put in all the numbers on the clock and show the hands pointing to a certain time. 10 minutes after 11 o'clock is what we use, because that's a little complicated. And then you go back after they draw the face of the clock and see how many words they can remember. If they miss words or miss the drawing on the face of the clock, that may be a positive mini-cog. And you can do that. Here's the MoCA. The MoCA looks like that piece of paper on the left. That's the sheet we use. We ask people to do something that's called trail making. That's that jumble of letters and numbers. We ask them to go from a number to a letter to the next number, next letter. That's the first part of it. And then we ask them to copy that cube in the middle there, that cube. And then on the right, we ask them to draw the face of the clock with the hands pointing to 11:10. And then the second row are cartoon drawings of three types of animals. We ask them to name those animals, a lion, rhino, and camel. And then the next line is five words that we give them to recall later on. And the line after that, the next lines look at ability to repeat a sentence exactly, the ability to do some other things that require mental processing. Like, for example, to subtract 7 from 100 and keep subtracting 7 from the answer for 5 times. Try that. See what you do with that. And then at the bottom there, we ask them to recall the 5 words. And that's the MoCA test that we use to see. And if it reaches a certain level, we assume that's more than just normal aging. But these are screening tests that we use. So the question that always comes up is, what's the difference between Alzheimer's disease and dementia? I don't know if my loved one has dementia or do they have Alzheimer's disease. I understand somebody may have explained that to you, but dementia means brain failure that's demonstrated by thinking difficulty as well as other things. Things like visual spatial things. That's why people with dementia are bad drivers, and that's why they get lost in common surroundings. Things like word naming. You know, hand me that, that thing you write with instead of pen and so forth. And in dementia, this difficulty is severe enough to cause impairment in day-to-day function so that people often can't function anymore. They can't be trusted to cook because they may leave things on the stove. They can't be trusted to turn the water on because they may forget to turn the water off. I do sometimes. Dementia is a measurement of severity of the impairment. And there are a lot of things that may cause dementia. And here are some of them. So Alzheimer's is the most common type of dementia, but other things can cause dementia, like strokes or tumors or too much drinking, the impact of that, something called Korsakoff's, or vascular dementia caused by vessel disease in the brain. Or if you have Parkinson's disease, there's a special kind of dementia called dementia with Lewy bodies. All those are types of dementia, and dementia is memory problems plus some other cognitive deficits severe enough to cause the need to have someone to help you out in day-to-day life. And Alzheimer's accounts for at least 70% of all of the dementias. Alzheimer's disease is a neurodegenerative brain disease, which means brain cells die. It has a gradual, not a rapid onset. If you see somebody that has stepwise decline in their memory and functioning, that's more likely due to strokes, series of strokes, and not Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease comes on very gradually. And the early hallmark in Alzheimer's is the inability to learn and retain new information. Alzheimer's generally impacts those of us 60 plus years, 65 years of age and older, although there is a case, and I'll tell you about it, where it affects people like Mrs. Dieter and comes on in people's 40s and 50s. We've even heard of cases in late 30s where early onset Alzheimer's. So we recognize Alzheimer's disease. First thing to show up is generally the memory problems. But the other cognitive problems can be attention and focus. You know, you're talking about something and the person with the disease is not paying attention. And we'll ask you a question about what you've just said because they're not paying attention and they're not focusing. New learning is problematic. Old learning sticks with us. the stuff that happens from 40 years ago, 50, 60 years ago, we can remember like it was yesterday. What happened this morning, what we had for breakfast, we can't quite remember. Problems with communication and language, visual perception, reasoning and judgment, something that we call executive functioning. People with Alzheimer's disease may be able to make eggs, to get orange juice, to get toast, but they can't make breakfast. Because making breakfast requires that you use executive function and put things together. These are the stages of Alzheimer's disease. You have them in your outline. I'm not going to go over them. But look at the fact that the process often takes 14, 15 years to go from the early signs to death. And it always ends in death. So the stages are the early stages where you see the early signs. The second stages are where those signs get worse and have greater impact. And the last stage is where usually people need to be cared for all the time. The evaluation. First of all, the problems with getting the evaluation. There's a stigma. When most of us think about Alzheimer's, what do we think about? The person in the nursing home slumping over and drooling and not with the program anymore. Well, that's the end stage, tragically. But in the early stages, that's not what people look like. And the stigma that goes with, I don't even want to think about that end stage, is there. And it keeps people from seeking out help. People don't observe. You've been married a long time. You know how to fill in the sentences that your partner is getting ready to say. And often what we see early in the disease is covering up. Since you know what she was talking about is a pen, you just fill it in. And you don't say, gosh, I wonder why she can't recall that's a pen, and called it the thing you write with, etc. And then there's fear. The fear of what's coming next, if we are right. How do we evaluate it now? Because it may be different, hopefully, in years to come. We start with a physical exam and a medical exam. That's important. You don't generally start with the psychologist. You start with the physician first. Why? Because it may be a medical condition that the person is suffering from. It could be a stroke. It could be a tumor. It could be a vitamin deficiency. It could be medication. Sometimes people, and especially today, are taking so many medicines, they don't know what the heck they're even taking. And many of the medicines confuse people and look like Alzheimer's disease. And if you just stop the medicine, the sleeping medicine or the tranquilizer medicine or something else, the bladder medicine, or it may be that they might clear up. And that's why a medical exam is helpful. And then you do lab work, not because there's any lab test for Alzheimer's, but you look for things like thyroid dysfunction, vitamin B12, diabetes, and other things that could be causing symptoms that look like Alzheimer's. And then you get the neuropsychological testing, and that's important. So the neuropsychological testing starts with the memory screen, like the MoCA or the MMSE mini mental status exam. But the real definitive diagnosis is made by much more complicated and longer tests. The MoCA takes about 15 minutes or less. Neuropsychological testing, and the one we most commonly use is called the ADAS-COG, the Alzheimer's Disease State Evaluation. Takes generally an hour or several hours to do. But with that test done by a neuropsychologist, we can tell not only how bad is the dementia, but what different domains does it include. And then we do brain imaging, especially an MRI. Now, why do we do brain imaging? It's not to diagnose Alzheimer's, because we don't have an MRI test for Alzheimer's. But what we do the MRI for is to make sure that it's not something else. It's not a tumor. It's not a stroke. It's not a blood vessel problem. And that's what the MRI picks up. And Medicare pays for the MRI. Doesn't pay for some of the other tests. What do you do if the diagnosis does exist? Let's say we can make the diagnosis. Do we want to tell the family or the person what it is? We ain't got no cure for it. Maybe it's better if we don't tell it. And it's the same argument that's used for cancer and other diagnoses. The answer is, I think it's important that the family understand and the patient understands as much as they can. Why? We want to make sure that the evaluation is done to make sure it's Alzheimer's disease and not some other kind of dementia. We don't have good treatments for some of the other kinds, but we do have good treatments for some of them. Like, there's a condition called increased pressure hydrocephalus, whereas there's an accumulation of fluid in the brain, and we can actually put in a little valve to reduce the pressure and relieve the symptoms. So we want to make sure it's not something we can treat or do something about. And people with Alzheimer's may have other diseases, like depression, or like heart disease, or like diabetes, or like something else that we can treat. So we want to do the evaluation to see if there's something else that we can treat. We want to initiate lifestyle changes. There's a lot of controversy about it, but it sure don't hurt nothing except the pocketbook to make some of the lifestyle changes, and I'll talk about some of those. We want to get help. We want to start preparing for the future. If we're facing a 14-year battle that's very costly and very emotionally problematic, we want to know about it so we can do it right. We want to have support not only for the person with the disease, but the family members and caretakers. We can begin drug treatment that doesn't treat the underlying disease, but can slow it down, the symptoms down a little bit, and do some good in the process. And the sooner we initiate those treatments, the better. We want to educate the family about the disease and about research and the place research plays. And then we want to be prepared in case new treatments come along so that we can preserve the memory as long as we can. Because who knows what's coming tomorrow or next week, next month, next year. The genetics of Alzheimer's disease. The genetics. How many of you saw the movie I'm Still Alice? Alice had early onset dementia. Remember, Alice was in her, I think, 40s or 50, or early 50s when she developed her disease. Early onset dementia is generally genetic and tends to run in families. Now, there is some good news, and that is you get one copy of the gene, the presenilin gene, from each parent. So if you only get one copy of the gene, your chances of getting it are not the same as both copies. Both copies, it's pretty sure you're going to get it. There is a family in Colombia that has early onset Alzheimer's. and everybody in that family has it. And it gives those of us in research a chance to study family members, because we know it's coming, even if they don't have it now, and we can do some things about it. But that's the for sure genetic part of it. Now, as you get older, there are some risk factors that increase your risk, and I'll go over them in just a minute. But as you get past 65, the biggest risk factor is just your age. It's not your genes. And a lot of us don't know what our genes are going to provide for us. My mother had dementia, but hers was called multi-infarct dementia from strokes, not Alzheimer's disease. My father died in his early 30s of a heart attack, and he had no memory problems. So we don't know what my genetics really are. And a lot of people don't. And as you get older, it's just the luck of the draw. 1 out of 10 in the mid-60s, and when you hit mid-80s, 1 out of 3. And that's the most common kind of dementia. Let's talk about the risk factors. Many of you have heard about this gene called the APOE4 gene. It is a risk factor. It's a protein, not a gene, I'm sorry. Apolipoprotein E4. And it is associated not only with dementia, but early heart disease and blood vessel disease as well. Now, there are a lot, your chances of getting Alzheimer's disease, if you get one copy of the gene from both parents, is 10 times greater than if you don't have it. If you've only got one copy of the gene, it's only 3 times higher, and it's certainly not for sure. So there are many people with APOE4 who will not get Alzheimer's disease. And there's some argument that it's not really even worth doing the test for the APOE4 gene, because it's not certain and it's not always predictive. So it worries people, perhaps unnecessarily. Heart disease may be a little different matter. But you see on the right side, there's some other risk factors. Diabetes, especially uncontrolled type 1 diabetes. Depression is a risk factor. Being black, cardiovascular disease. And the last one we know about, the head injuries. We're seeing in football players with multiple concussions, they get traumatic brain encephalopathy, but also a much higher risk for dementia as well. And our worry about these troops coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan who were exposed to all these blast injuries is they may be at higher risk for dementia later. How do we treat it? Today, we educate about it through things like this. We need support for the patient and support for the family members and caregivers. And we use medications. So the medications we use today are of two types. One is called the acetylcholinesterase inhibitors. Acetylcholine is a chemical in the brain that helps with memory. What happens in Alzheimer's is we think the neurons, the brain cells that produce acetylcholine die, and you have less acetylcholine. So one thing you can do is squeeze out every last bit of acetylcholine, and that's what these drugs do. It's like giving drugs for Parkinson's disease. In Parkinson's disease, the chemical is called dopamine. And we give people L-DOPA, which is a type of dopamine, because the cells that are producing their dopamine are dying. And so as long as we can squeeze out a little more, the symptoms look a little better. The problem is the cells that are producing the chemical are dying. And you can't squeeze out where there's no more chemical. But these drugs, Aricept is the most common. There's a patch called the Exelon patch. There's another one called Razanine. These drugs cause a little nausea and gastrointestinal upset, but they're relatively safe drugs. And then there's another class of drugs. Namenda is the most common one of those, and it works on a different brain chemical called glutamate. And then there's a combination of Aricept and Namenda called Namzeric, which is the new drug. Here's what it looks like, the decline in mental functioning with Alzheimer's. That's the red line. So over time, the functioning of memory and cognition is declining. What happens when we give Aricept or Namenda is we remove some of the symptoms with that line on the top, the blue line. The symptoms look better, and in fact are better. But what you notice is the decline is still the same. It's still declining. We're not changing the course of the disease. We're making the symptoms less noticeable. And that could be a blessed thing. If it keeps somebody out of a nursing home or keeps a family from having to provide round-the-clock care, that's a good thing. If we can see our loved ones functioning better, that's a good thing. Even though we know the overall decline is still there. So these drugs like Aricept and Namenda are not treatments. They're symptom removers for a little bit. But the disease is still tragically processing. I mentioned lifestyle. I'm sure there are lots of questions about these, and I'm going to go through them very quickly. Which one of these do you think has the most chance of helping maybe prevent or deal with the symptoms of Alzheimer's? Which of these? Exercise, mental stimulation, diet improvement, alcohol, nutritional supplements? The answer is, from a scientific standpoint, it's exercise. There are actually studies that show that if you exercise 20 minutes, 5 times a week, you can actually increase the size of certain parts of the brain that have to do with memory, like the hippocampus. How about mental stimulation? Ain't a bad thing. The more mental stimulation you can have, the more reserved you might get in terms of more cells in the brain being stimulated. So doing Sudoku, doing crossword puzzles, reading, doing things that provide brain stimulation are good. So, a wise doctor, what about luminosity? Doesn't luminosity do it better? And the answer is there's actually no data that it does. But there are brain stimulation exercises that are being developed at UCLA by a guy named Gary Small. There are lots of brain stimulation things you can do that are a heck of a lot cheaper than luminosity. And if you want to spend your money on luminosity, do it. I mean, if it makes you feel better that you're doing something, do it. But the research shows that if you practice luminosity, you can get better at luminosity, but not necessarily about your disease. How about diet? The Mediterranean diet has been studied the most, and there's some research that maybe it helps, but not as much as what we would hope. But it doesn't hurt, and it helps your heart. How about improvement of sleep? Getting enough sleep is important. There's some question as to whether getting sleep with pills is the same as getting sleep without pills. And the jury's not back on that just yet. But trying to get more sleep is important. Alcohol, how about that? Red wine. So it turns out that in red wine, there is a chemical called resveratrol. And resveratrol may help with heart and may help decrease the severity of Alzheimer's. The question then is, does taking resveratrol in a pill do the same as drinking the glass of wine? The research would suggest probably not. That taking the pill is better than doing nothing, but we're not actually sure how much of that pill gets across into the brain, gets to other parts of the body. But drinking the glass of wine may. Now, as I say that, the problem with that is the fact that a little's good, a lot's not so good. And one of the big problems we're having today in the elderly is problem drinking. The glasses of brandy, the drinks of wine turn into something more than just a glass of wine at night. Or it is just a glass of wine at night. It's so some alcohol is good, but Anne and I are trying to remember our glass of wine every night. How about the nutritional supplements? I wish I could tell you the data is better. It doesn't mean that they don't help, but it means the research isn't in yet. We do depression studies at Clinical Trials of Texas, as well as do Alzheimer's and other studies. The way we do depression studies is we're testing a drug for depression. So half the people with depression get the real drug, and the other half get what we call placebo, which are inert substances. Now, why do we give people placebo? We give it because sometimes just the effect of thinking you're going to get better makes you better. But if you weren't taking a pill, you'd say, but heck, I can't be getting better because I ain't taking nothing. So to do away with that, we give them a pill that doesn't have anything that's active in it. What percent of patients with severe depression who get that placebo pill do you think get better? And the answer is over 40%. And these are people with severe depression, not mamby-pamby depression. 40% get better. That's called the placebo effect. So if you believe that that pill you're taking is going to make you better, whether it's ginkgo biloba or sandhi or coconut oil or cumin or whatever it is, or maybe even the jellyfish stuff, if you believe that it's going to help you, there are a lot of people that are going to get better, and they're going to swear by it as making them better. That, by the way, is the gimmick with most of the weight loss nutritional supplements. People are going to lose weight, but it may not be because of the chemical in the nutritional supplement. One other thing about nutritional supplements, they are not regulated as drugs. There's an act, in case some of you are interested, it's called DHSEA, D-H-S-E-A, the Dietary Health and Supplement Education Act. I think it was passed in the 80s. Or 70, whatever. It was passed because at that time they were giving people, what was the stuff, beta carotene, and it was supposed to make your eyes better and all that stuff, and it turned everybody orange. There was this epidemic of orange, and the Congress tried to pass a law to regulate nutritional supplements, and the lobby was so strong, they not only did not pass the bill to regulate them, they passed a bill that unregulated them. So a nutritional supplement, regardless of what they say on the TV ad, does not have to have one single study, not one, that proves that their stuff works. And they don't have to have one single study, not one, that shows that their stuff is safe. And they don't have to have in the pill what the bottle says it has in the pill. So the bottle can say it has 5 milligrams of something, and the pill can contain no milligrams of something, and that's perfectly legal under the shed. The reason I tell you that is, even if we found nutritional supplements at work, we don't know that that particular nutritional supplement has got anything in it. We know, for example, that coconut oil does have an impact. The problem is there's only 10% of the coconut oil that's active. And there's question whether that 10% gets across into the brain. It gets across to other parts of the body. But as long as you're willing to spend the dough on it, it doesn't hurt anything other than your pocketbook. The jellyfish stuff is under investigation, as you may have heard. The Federal Trade Commission is on them for claims. What causes Alzheimer's disease? Remember, Alzheimer's found those plaques? That's a plaque. And the plaque in the brain is caused by something called beta amyloid. And that gave rise to the beta amyloid hypothesis, which came out in the mid late 90s. There's a protein in the brain called amyloid precursor protein. We think the purpose of amyloid in the brain is to fight off inflammation. That may be the purpose, we don't know. But you can cut this long protein by a matter of chemicals in the brain. Gamma secretase on the top, it cuts the protein nicely where it should be cut, and the body processes it and it gets rid of it. But if you have other chemicals that cut it, one is called beta secretase, and the other is called gamma secretase, and those cut the precursor protein wrong, and it starts folding up on itself, and it gloms up, and it causes these plaques. And then the other part of the story is something called tau protein. And tau is this black stuff that Dr. Alzheimer saw, and that comes later than the amyloid. And those things, we believe, cause inflammation and kill off brain cells. This is just a little graph. I know it's kind of hoity-toity, but here's what it means. See that red line? That's the accumulation of amyloid in the brain. People start accumulating amyloid in the brain 15 years before they get to mild cognitive impairment. So it's starting to accumulate early, but it's hard to find in the brain unless you have the right kind of machines, and we'll talk about that. So by the time people are developing mild cognitive impairment, looky here, there's about as much of that amyloid in the brain as there's going to be. And it's already there. This is what a brain with Alzheimer's disease looks like. On the left, you see it's shrunken. There's all those places in the brain where there ain't no brain tissue, as opposed to the nice brain on the right. The future, right now, we cannot make the diagnosis for sure until somebody dies. And we do an autopsy just like Dr. Alzheimer did. We use better chemicals now than photographic chemicals, but we still look for the plaques and the tangles. And it's too late to make the diagnosis when they're on the slab having an autopsy. So what we're looking for now is what's called biomarkers. Now, I know you don't much care about that, but when you read stuff or hear stuff, you'll understand what they're talking about. So a biomarker is an easily measured something, either an X-ray or an MRI scan or a blood test or something that indicates the presence of a otherwise hard to measure kind of disease. Here are some of the biomarkers that we're looking at now. The hippocampus is the part of the brain where memory is stored. And we're looking at hippocampal atrophy on MRI. Remember that Medicare pays for MRI. They don't pay for other fancier scans, but they do pay for MRIs. So we're hoping maybe we can pick up that kind of atrophy, though we can't pick up amyloid or other things on the MRI. We can look at things called PET scans, and there are two types of PET scans. PET stands for positron emission tomography, and what it is a fancy dancy CT scan that's done with chemicals that emit radioactive material that we can see. And so there's a cheap kind of PET that's called the FDG PET that sometimes Medicare pays for, but it doesn't show the amyloid. It just shows what parts of the brain are being affected. It's still pretty expensive. The fancy-dancy stuff is called the amyloid PET or the tau PET. So we now have chemicals that glom on to amyloid or tau in the brain, and they emit radioactive waves that are picked up by this PET scanner. I'll show you what that looks like in a second. We can do spinal fluid evaluation. We do in the studies that we do at clinical trials on Alzheimer's. We're looking for genetic mutations like the presenilin gene and others. There's an eye test that's now being tested. It turns out that amyloid not only deposits in the brain, but it deposits in the back of the eye, the retina, and in the cornea. And you can stain the eye and look at it in the eye doctor's office and pick up amyloid. And that's being tested by the FDA now. Some of you may have read about the smell test. There's actually a smell test using peanut butter that's being tested, and it indicates something about the brain. This is what a PET scan looks like. See the one on the far right in living color? The red is the accumulation of amyloid. The bottom one is a normal brain without amyloid. Here's an MRI scan. Here's the one for the other, the tab. What are we doing to try to prevent Alzheimer's disease? Remember I told you if you break that precursor protein in the right place, it's good. If you break it in the wrong place, it's bad. So the thing that breaks it in the right place is called alpha secretase. So there's tests looking at chemicals, at drugs, that increase the activity of alpha secretase. Remember I told you beta and gamma secretase on the second row are bad because they cut it in the wrong place, so there's the amyloid that accumulates. There are drugs now being developed to block the activity of gamma secretase and beta secretase. Unfortunately, the latest trial done by Merck just failed last week or a couple of weeks ago. We're working on a beta secretase inhibitor in clinical trials. The other thing is, what if we could decrease the accumulation of amyloid? So how are we gonna do that? Well, what if we could give people a vaccine so they wouldn't accumulate beta amyloid? We tried that, and unfortunately caused the brain to swell up, and they gave up. The other thing they're trying is what are called antibodies. So what if we could find an antibody that gloms on to the beta amyloid and gets rid of it? Wouldn't that be cool? The Eli Lilly drug, solanezumab, just failed in its trials a month ago, and it was the greatest hope. But we're working on a monoclonal antibody now as well. So that may be the hope for the future. And then there are other things that we hope might work. This is the Alzheimer prevention trials that are being done primarily by the Alzheimer's Association and National Institutes of Mental Health. The point is, they're trials that people can get into. They're trials that people can get into that have the APOE4 gene, but nothing else, no other symptoms. They're trials for people that have family histories, but nothing else. They're what are called registration trials, where we follow people for many years to see what happens. How can you help? Remember I told you the government ain't spending enough. The pharmaceutical companies are getting a little weary. An Alzheimer trial runs in the neighborhood of about $300 million. And when that drug peters out and doesn't work, who pays? Pharma companies are in the business of making money. $300 million is a big loss. And unfortunately, there are a lot of those, and people are getting wary of doing it. Private philanthropy is needed where public funding has failed. Support national and local Alzheimer's associations. That's so important because that's the place that's advocating for Alzheimer's disease. Volunteer whenever you can, and if you can, because there's lots of places people are needed. And I'd like to encourage everybody to encourage other people. Participate in trials. Clinical trials are the hope. Without them, we ain't got nothing. I mean, you know, and if you don't want to do it for the good of mankind, it's a chance, if you've got a relative, family member, or friend with Alzheimer's, to get them care. They're going to get PET scans. A PET scan costs between $5,000 and $7,000 and is not covered by insurance or Medicare. They get PET scans. They get cerebral spinal fluid evaluations. They get lab tests. They get seen every few weeks or every few months for a period of 18 months to 2 years. And that can be important. And at least somebody is paying attention to the process. And so, I want to thank for this these people, Dr. Morgan, Dr. Cohen, Dr. Longo, Kirchhoff, and Dr. Small. I used some of their information and some of their slides in this talk. And I want to thank all of you for coming today and for listening to me. I wish I could stay longer. I'm sure there are lots of questions. I answered lots of questions at the Caregiver Summit. 6 or so months ago. Unfortunately, I have to leave today. Thank you all very, very much.
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. All that you can rely.